welcome to the stage, David Marriott.
Well, good evening, everybody. Great to be with all of you. I believe there are some slides here as well so that I can talk a little bit about what I do when I'm not busy at work and where my passions lie. So when I'm not busy at work, I'm usually with my family, spending good quality time with them, and we like to spend time outdoors. And I'm a very passionate, avid dirt bike rider and have been riding dirt bikes since I was about the age of 8 years old. So that's how I find my happy place and what I do with my time when I'm away, and that helps me find that great balance of wellness along with the hard work that we deliver each and every day on our day jobs with my other Marriott family. So I know many of you have heard the story of my grandparents and how the business got started, but you're going to hear it again, and there's a reason that you're going to hear it again. We feel that our most significant competitive advantage at Marriott is our culture and our core values. And we feel that through understanding our history and the founding story, that we will be able to provide important insights into who we are and who we are striving to become. So today I'm going to give you a little bit of a glimpse into our DNA. Over 91 years ago, my grandparents created a culture of opportunity, which has changed the lives of literally hundreds of thousands of people around the globe. And it all really started from humble beginnings in the year 1900, when my grandfather was born on a farm outside of Ogden, Utah. He had to drop out of school after the sixth grade to care for his father's sheep. He would take those sheep into the mountains of Nevada and Utah so that they would have fresh water and grass during the hot summer months when everything dried out in the valley. And he worked hard on the beet farm through the other months of the year when he wasn't in the mountains protecting those sheep from bears and snakes and all the other things that come with living in the mountains throughout the summer. He went on a mission for the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints to New England, and on his way home from his mission, at the age of about 20, 21 years old, he went through Washington, D.C. in the middle of the summer. Well, he felt the heat and the humidity in Washington, and he had an outrageous idea. He said this would be a fabulous place to open a root beer stand one day. He said people will love root beer in this hot climate. But he knew that getting an education was extremely important, and he knew that he did not have that education. When he returned home to Utah, he befriended a professor who taught English at Weber State University, a two-year college in Ogden, Utah, and that professor sponsored and supported him so that he could obtain his education. He got his two-year associate's degree at Weber State and then went on to the University of Utah, where he graduated and got his bachelor's. While at the University of Utah, he met my grandmother. And there's a lot of stories that people know about my grandfather, but people don't know quite as much about my grandmother. Well, let me tell you, she was an absolutely remarkable woman. She was the youngest graduate of the University of Utah, graduating at the age of 19. With a double major in English and Spanish. So think about that, 1927. She was really breaking a lot of ground for women at the time. They both decided to pursue their dream. They got married and they moved to Washington, D.C. to open a root beer stand. They drove across the U.S. 2,000 miles, 11 days on dirt roads in a Model T Ford. They had to stop about every 100, 150 miles to fill the radiator up with water because the car was continuously overheating. But they made it to Washington, and on May 20th, 1927, my grandparents opened a 9-seat root beer stand just as Washington, D.C. was entering into another muggy, hot summer. Was actually the same day that Lindbergh crossed the Atlantic on the Spirit of St. Louis, and my grandfather would later say that Lindbergh stole all of his press. They began selling their root beer 5 cents a mug, and root beer sold like crazy through the summer months. They did really well. My grandmother would collect the sticky nickels and take them to the bank across the street. As the summer months cooled and they got into the fall, root beer sales, as you can imagine, started to decline, and they decided they needed to reinvent their business and look at things a little differently. So my grandmother used her Spanish, went to the Mexican embassy, obtained their recipes for hot tamales and chili, and started cooking hot dogs, hamburgers, tamale, chili in her little apartment across the street from the root beer stand, and they renamed their restaurant the Hot Shops. The restaurant continued to thrive, and they looked for opportunities and ways to expand their business. They would literally stand on the corner with a clicker in their hand, counting the number of people that would walk by the corner or the number of cars that would drive by to select those next locations for their restaurants as they would expand. My grandfather continued with that innovative spirit. He worked hard with the government in D.C. to get the curbs cut so that cars could drive up to the restaurant and they could serve food to the cars with the running boys. As cars would roll down their windows and accept the food. He also noticed that several customers were coming into one of their stores, which was located relatively close to what was at the time Hoover Airfield, which was the airport in Northern Virginia, right next to Washington. He noticed that these customers would come into the store and they would take food to go and take that food on the airplane with them. So he decided that he needed to buy some trucks, put food on the trucks, and drive that food out onto the tarmac and put that food on the airplanes before people would travel. And he essentially got in-flight catering off the ground in an early partnership with Eastern Airlines. But they founded their business very early on with a core value, and you've heard it earlier today. You'll hear it again throughout the conference, I'm sure. But if you take good care of your associates, they will take good care of the customer, and the customer will come back. They even hired a doctor in those early years and put the doctor on payroll to take care of our associates' medical needs, and this was long before healthcare was in existence for associates, of course. The business survived the Great Depression and continued to grow through my grandparents' hard work, through their innovative spirit, and the belief that if you serve the communities within which you work, your entire community will benefit from those efforts. And for the first 30 years of the company, we were solely focused on food and beverage. And Julius mentioned the Sheraton brand having been around for 81 years. We opened our hotel, our very first hotel, 20 years after the first Sheraton opened in 1957, on a piece of land in Arlington, Virginia that my grandfather had acquired called the Twin Bridges Marriott. At the time, it was the largest motor hotel. And my grandfather was looking for somebody to oversee and watch over this hotel. And my father raised his hand and he said, "I want to look after this hotel, Dad." And my grandfather looked at him and he said, "Well, Bill, you don't know anything about the hotel business." My dad looked at him and he said, "Well, nobody else around here knows anything about the hotel business either, so give me an opportunity," and so he did. And so my father oversaw our very first hotel, the Twin Bridges Marriott in Arlington, Virginia. The hotel did very well during the busy months in D.C., during the spring and in the fall, but as it got into the hotter summer months, business slowed, and my father recognized that he needed to appeal to the group segment. They built a ballroom on the hotel and appealed to the corporate and association business nearby Washington, D.C. to help support the slower seasons of the year. And so our great relationship with our tremendous group customers were born in those early years. Just 2 years later in 1959, the Key Bridge Marriott opened just down from Twin Bridges, still in operation today with a great plan to reinvent it, which we're all thrilled about. But we continue to remain innovative, seeking opportunities to grow our business. In the 80s, we got into all sorts of different businesses, from theme parks, to cruise ships, to timeshare, to acquiring select service and extended stay brands, truly becoming the first hotel company with multiple brands across multiple segments. And it took us 43 years for us to open our first 2,000 hotels. Then took us 14 years to add the next 2,000 hotels, and through the Starwood acquisition, just 3 years to open the next 2,000 hotels. So tremendous growth over our history. Through this growth and change over this 91-year history, our culture and our core values have always remained the same and been consistent. Today, we're singularly focused on hospitality with a vision to be the world's favorite travel company. A few years ago, we sat down and defined our core values as putting people first, pursuing excellence, embracing change, acting with integrity, and serving our world. And as a company grows, it becomes more and more difficult and challenging for a company to really keep to those core values that make your business so special. But today, we remain a family business. My father, as Arnie can attest, is a very involved and engaged executive chairman at the age of 86. My sister Debbie heads up our culture and core values to ensure that we remain focused on what has given us such a strong competitive advantage over our history. Her husband Ron heads up our architecture and design division, and I have several nephews that are entering the business as well. And Arnie has been a tremendous steward of our culture and core values as he has taken the role as our chairman and CEO. Our GMs, however, I believe are the true stewards of our culture. Each of them knows how important it is to pull through the values of taking care of our associates and taking care of our guests. And they know how important it is to relate to those associates and listen to them and respond to their needs and really understand how to support them in all that they do. They help reinforce our ability to serve the community through their business councils, in which they are involved in within each of our markets around the globe. So as we talk about putting people first, this really goes back to the philosophy that my grandparents implemented in the beginning, which I touched on. We view our associates as our most important assets and the reason for our success over our more than 90-year history. You can often hear my father say that the thing he is the most proud of in his career are the opportunities that we have been able to provide for our people, the opportunities of growth and development. And there are countless examples within our company of senior executives that have rose through the hourly ranks to general manager and into senior leadership roles. This last spring, we celebrated our 30th JW Marriott Award of Excellence, where associates are awarded for going above and beyond in the service of our guests. It's really our version of the Academy Awards. It's easy to build great hotels, but the real trick is in hiring, training, and retaining the best people so that all of your needs are met. As we talk about pursuing excellence, one of my father's favorite sayings is success is never final, and we have always strived to be the best at what we do, never being comfortable with where we're at and always striving for more. We were the first to develop a loyalty program within our industry. We were the first hotel company with a full portfolio of brands. Today we have 30 brands, as highlighted earlier, with over 6,700 hotels in over 129 countries around the globe. And we continue to challenge ourselves to reinvent our business model and look for new and innovative ways to achieve our vision to be the world's favorite travel company. Over our company's history, we have been a fantastic example of embracing change. Marriott has continually evolved to address our customers' needs. We were just ranked number 18 on the Forbes list of the world's most innovative companies. And our acquisition of Starwood has helped boost us even more in that space, as they have had a tremendous reputation over the years of being edgy and creative. The W chain really put lifestyle on the map, And Weston, of course, brought about the heavenly bed and heavenly shower, which were game changers in the industry. My grandfather often did business with a handshake. In fact, the Key Bridge Marriott Hotel, which I touched on, I believe, was settled over a handshake, and there were lots, I think, of details that had to be worked through later, years down the road, to ensure that everything was intact and recorded for that great hotel. But how we do business is as important as the business that we do, and I think we all agree that this is absolutely a non-negotiable. It's at the heart of everything. We continually are recognized among the best companies in the world to work for because of our focus on integrity. As mentioned previously, serving our world has always been an important principle for Marriott. We have a tremendous partnership with Children's Miracle Network, and sustainability has always been a huge focus for us as well, and even more so in the last few years. In May, we had our Associate Appreciation Week. Many of our associates around the globe are involved during this week in serving nonprofit organizations and supporting the communities within which they work. Our business councils and hotel teams help organize efforts to serve these communities. So again, I mentioned this phrase. This might be my dad's favorite phrase. Well, his favorite word is more. He would like to see us have more hotels, more brands, more markets, more successes, create more opportunities. But it's been a real blessing in my life to have such an amazing father, an amazing mentor, and someone that I can call my best friend and my hero. I'm incredibly passionate about keeping our family's legacies, values alive. I couldn't have had a better example than in my father and in my grandfather in terms of serving others, working hard, and doing what's right. So I thank all of you for your tremendous partnership. It's an honor and a privilege to be with all of you here in Marco, one of my favorite hotels. And we want to thank you so much for your continued partnership, for the business that you bring to us, for giving us the ability to get better each and every day, and for giving us feedback and letting us know how we can serve your needs better. So thank you very much. It's a true pleasure to be with all of you this evening, and I look forward to seeing you throughout tonight and tomorrow morning. All the best.
Please welcome back to the stage, Gail Frazier.
So I want to sincerely thank this afternoon's presenters, the wonderful Doreen Burse and Tammy Ruth, and Julius Robinson. Exciting times ahead for the Sheraton brand. And of course, thank you to David Marriott for speaking about Marriott's history and culture and showing how the standards set all those years ago still guide us today. So to help me finish up, I'm going to introduce you to a friend that I know you'll learn to love if you don't already. So someone that you may be sharing a room with, but it's okay, because you can tell your significant other that you're sharing a room with an incredibly brilliant and attractive friend. So as you know, we are piloting voice technology in our hotels. So let's give it a try. Please welcome our new in-room assistant, Alexa. Alexa, I'd like you to meet the wonderful people I was telling you about.
Oh, hello, Gail. Wow, this is a big crowd. Smart, too. How can I help you?
I'd like you to tell our audience about tonight's welcome reception.
Okay, sure. Tonight's welcome reception begins at 6:30 p.m. sharp in the Sunset Terrace.
Great. Are there any more details you'd like to share?
I have heard rumors that David Marriott is actually an incredible breakdancer. Also, the bartender makes a killer old-fashioned. I should know. Last night, I ordered one from room service, and it nearly fried my circuit board. I should have known that digital assistants and liquids really don't go together.
I am so sorry to hear about that. I'm really glad you're okay, but I think that's about it.
Oh no, Gail, that's not it. We've got to get this crowd ready for a party. I'd be forever indebted to you if you'd bring back out that hunky violinist. I'm blushing.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back, Jared Burnett.
Thank you.